I quite like this Stag that Mike's bought us. The bodywork's sound, the interior looks good, but it hasn't been a daily driver for quite some time now, so there's loads of mechanical things for me to get stuck into. The first job I want to tackle is that leak coming from the engine bay, and it's coming from right at the top of the engine underneath the cam cover. So it's up with the bonnet and on with the job.
The cam cover gasket is the seal between the cam cover and the cylinder head. They often fail on old British sports cars, so many Triumph enthusiasts will recognise this next job.
Now, that engine is a glorious British V8, but it's not the Rover engine everybody knows and loves. It's the rather less-known Triumph unit. Now, it does have a wondrous growl, and Mike says it pulls like an express train, but this little leak down here means that all is not well with our cam cover gasket, and that is a rather thick cork membrane that seals between the cylinder head and our cam cover. So, it's spanner time.
The airbox clips straight off. And then, I just have to remove the air filter. And then the air intake beneath it. So far, so straightforward. Judging by the condition of the parts I'm taking off, this engine has been well looked after. With all of that out of the way, I can unscrew and remove the cam cover and get to the gasket.
Let's have a look at this. Well, there doesn't seem to be any obvious damage. I think really the only reason we've got a leak at all is just because of old age. It's perished, it's gone hard and crispy. And rather than being lovely and soft, and so of course when the engine heats up and cools down, the metal parts kind of move around, and this just isn't doing its sealing job. So what we need to do is remove that and replace it for a brand new one. Now it has been stuck down in a few places with a bit of sealant. I'm going to be using a scraper. I could use something like a razor blade or whatever, but of course it'd have to be quite a blunt one because I'd be very careful I don't damage the surface of either the cylinder head or of this cam cover. So very simply just work it through here, let it lift up nice and easily. Okay, well, that can now go in the bin.
A dab of degreaser gets rid of the last bits of debris around the seam, and I may as well spruce up the cover as well.
Now, the cam cover is lovely and clean, so the next thing I need is a nice new gasket. So I've got one here. If I was just to place this into position, or even on the car for that matter, and then try and clamp it all down, chances are I could get it slightly squiffy, and then of course if I was to clamp it in the wrong position, it wouldn't do its job, it wouldn't seal properly. So nice top tip to get yourself some silicone sealant and just run a nice bead all the way around the outside, nothing too big, and then that way you can then put the gasket into position, hold it in place, leave it for say 15 minutes, and then when you go to put it onto the car, the gasket will be in exactly the right position. Very useful.
If you asked a garage to change the cam cover gaskets for you, they would probably charge you around £60, so it's well worth having a go yourself.
So now the next thing is the gasket. I want to kind of get this right first time if I can, so take it nice and easy.
The cork gasket needs to be pushed firmly onto the silicone, and any excess sealant should be wiped away.
What I want to do now is pop it over on the other side, let the weight of the cam cover, just keep that cork in position and leave it about 15 minutes or so, get that silicone to dry, and then I can pop this onto the car.
While the cam cover is drying, I'm making sure that the surface of the head is just as clean. Otherwise, you could end up with another leak.
Cylinder head is lovely and clean, so now it's time to get our cam cover with our gasket in position into position. And just pop that over there. Very, very careful I don't knock the gasket, but the silicone should have set by now, so that should be fine. Now, when it comes to doing these sort of nuts and bolts up, it does pay not to crush the cork gasket. They don't like it very much, and of course it's going to end up leaking again. Just get it sort of tight enough. You kind of get a feeling for when it stops compressing, and then probably in 1,000 miles time or so, just give it another nip up, just to be sure.
Now I can reassemble the air intake. But just before I put the airbox back on, there's one more job. As the car is a V8, there's a second bank of cylinders, and therefore a second head and cam cover. So I may as well replace its gasket too. It's only a couple more quid. That's all done. Back on with the cam cover. and back with the airbox. Now I need to get the engine up to temperature and check for leaks. Let there be none.
Well, I've had the engine running for a while now, so if there are going to be any leaks, I should be able to see them with my trusty torch here. Everything looks really good, so it seems that the gaskets are doing their job of sealing rather well. So with this job done, we're getting off to a flying start with our Stag.
Swapping a rad shouldn't ruin your day. First, undo the bottom hose on the radiator to drain the water out of the system, which of course will have to be disposed of at a recycling centre. Then disconnect the top hose. Finally, behind this panel, there are two nuts I need to undo which secure the bottom of the rad to the car.
Now everything's disconnected from the radiator, so it should just lift out. Might be a little bit heavy because it is just mostly brass. Right, there we go, one rubbish radiator removed from our Stag.
Before I plumb in the new rad, I can put on the hoses that Mike has kindly bought for me. Old hoses crack and fail, and ours are probably nearing the end of their natural life, so this makes perfect sense. I'm also going to swap the other hoses, which are harder to get to, buried deep in the engine bay.
And this one's slightly more complicated, because it's not just rubber, it's actually got a rusty steel tube that goes between the two there. And the reason the steel one is in there at all is because if you had a long length of rubber tube like that, there's a tendency for it to perhaps collapse and of course effectively work like a valve and then stop any flow of liquids, which would not be good at all. So they have put a steel pipe in there for a good reason, but of course now it's rusty, it's no use at all. The new one is stainless steel, which means it's going to last a lot longer. So while it's off the car, I'm just going to try and set this up so I've got the right pipes for the job in the right place.
A comprehensive kit with well-made parts makes this an easy job that I'd recommend you try yourself. Now I'm ready for the new rad, but will it fit?
OK, now this radiator is just a little bit bigger than our original one, but it's obviously designed to go into this space, so hopefully it'll just drop in and fit like a glove.
Brilliant, it fits. Now it's just a matter of attaching our new hoses to our new radiator.
Nearly there, it's the last hose. It's the top hose for the radiator. And like all of the other hoses, I've been securing it in place with a Jubilee clip. An amazing fact is that these things have been around even longer than Mike. They were invented in 1921 by Commander Lumley Robinson of the Royal Navy. They've been doing a fantastic job ever since.
And while you reflect on other momentous motoring moments, I'll just top up the system with coolant. This is tap water mixed with 50% antifreeze. You should change this annually. Now let's get that coolant circulating so I can bleed any air out of the system. The engine needs to be at working temperature with the thermostat fully open. Any air bubbles will be forced around the system and then vented naturally out through the open bleed screw. Time to find out if the new rad actually works.
If I just check my temperature gauge, yep, it's stuck on a rock solid normal. So it would seem that our radiator upgrade has worked beautifully, and we can now say with confidence that even on the hottest of days, our Triumph will remain lovely and cool.
Click here to subscribe.